from the Catholic Underground.
Today on the show, neighbors turn concierges in France and around the corner. Wearable tech is so hot right now. Weathering cultural storms with apostolates and confraternities and sacramentals, a special guest, and so much more. The Catholic Underground starts right now. Oh, my friends. Oh, it is time for the CU Weekly. We are cutting through the noise of the digital continent. It's episode number 290. I'm Father Chris Decker at Digital Catholic on Twitter. If you're joining live to listen to us on Roku or perhaps on YouTube, you can also go to the chat room at catholicunderground.tv and get your chat on with us. Joining me this week, we've got Olivia Galino. She is a student of life, our resident Italian food critic. She's always here. Oh, that's clever. Hey, Olivia.
Hello, everyone.
She's waving the Italian flag for all of you podcast listeners out there. We've also got Jason Elizondo. He is a dad husbandoid preacher. He's a tech geek and all-around Catholic. Hello, Jason.
Hello, Father.
It's good to see. Look, I can touch your shoulder.
We are within proximity of each other.
We are. Normally, we are virtually proximate.
That's right.
But Jason is with us. And, of course, we've got Jeff Blackwell, the technical director of the CU. He's the commandant of Jeff Star 1 Near Earth Orbit Satellite. And you're there. And you've got a guest on the satellite
today. Amazing Marissa Hornbuckle. She's joining us from Georgia in this week, kind of giving us a little lesson or two on how this automation system works that I know nothing about.
That's right. Blackwell and Hornbuckle sounds like a really awesome attorney at law.
Yeah, it is. You know, been injured in an accident.
That's right. And Ed, the dark crystal ball, is in the video cave. He's back from all of his travelings, his sojourns, and he's with us once again. Well, that was a really long introduction, but I think it was quite worth it because you can see that we have a good number of undergrounders that are here, and I'm excited because, boy, oh, boy, what a show. All right. So imagine, if you will, Olivia, that you have something that needs to be done. Say, for example, you need to go to the DMV to get your driver's license renewed, and you don't want to stand in line because you've got another line you've got to go stand in somewhere across town. There are services now that will allow for you to pay someone to do those things for you. Yes. In fact, there is one such service that's all the rage now in a few little neighborhoods in France called, are you ready? Loulou dans ma rue, which means Loulou on my street.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have a physical kiosk in one of the neighborhoods in France, and they're branching out to all the little neighborhoods in France. But essentially, you can call, you can go online, or you can go up to the kiosk and say, look, I need a concierge. So it's like a concierge service in your neighborhood.
Hmm.
Would you use that kind of a thing, Olivia?
It depends on what I needed it for. Having someone stand in the line of the DMV, perhaps.
Yeah, right.
Inviting someone into my home to fix my sink. It depends on if I had someone there, if I knew the person, you know.
Creepy Craigslist vibe.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I've never even used a concierge at a hotel, so, you know.
There is a hotel in Buffalo called The Mansion. It actually was a mansion, and they kind of made the mansion to a bunch of different rooms, and it's a hotel now. And all of their hotel workers, they called them butlers. And so they are all professional concierges. No matter anybody you stop in the hallway, you can ask them about anything in the city of Buffalo, and they will tell you. They will order you a car. They are all equally qualified to be a full-on concierge.
Hmm.
And that was one of my first experiences using a concierge, because I'm always a little like, do I tip you? Do I not tip you? How does that work? And so this is something that takes place in your neighborhood that, you know, you'd walk up and say, yeah, I don't know what to do about getting my sink fixed, or I need some dusting done in my study, because who doesn't need dusting done in their study, right?
Really?
Yeah, I mean, Jeff, your study is always just dusty.
That 409 just doesn't cut it anymore.
It doesn't get grease out of your way. It just gets more dust on the shelves. And so you can actually go up to a kiosk or call, or in the English version, there's something it's called Task Rabbit, you might have heard of. It's in a lot of the cities. You can just type it in on the internet and say, I need this done, and they will assign somebody who is willing to do that job for you.
Wow.
And I think maybe overarching, my question is this about just somebody making extra cash? Because I know in the instance of TaskRabbit, there's Rosemarie, who's on their front page, is one of the TaskRabbits, and she became a Tasker 3 years ago to help care for her grandson to make a little extra money. And so there's this notion of, I like to do stuff, I'm task-oriented, and so I can kind of do this for a living and make a little money doing it. Is this about hospitality, though?
Yeah.
Is this, I mean, because to me, I wonder if...
To me, it strikes me a little more as a cross between Uber and Craigslist.
Right.
You know,
right.
Like good a point. Like the best of both of those worlds. It's Uber for task-oriented needs. And I can see where, I think the Lulu website, you know, my French is terrible, but my Google Translate is a little better. But they were talking about bringing back the neighborhood kind of feel.
That concept I really like, right. that your neighbors are actually neighbors.
Right. And I can see that more with the Lulu model. I don't know as much with the TaskRabbit.
Right, because it would seem like if you, like Craigslist, I'm always kind of nervous whenever I'm meeting somebody from Craigslist to sell a cell phone or anything, but if it's the Lulu model, I agree. If it's neighborhood people, it's people that are around the neighborhood, or if it's just some random person that, if it's like TaskRabbit, it's like, we're going to let this person stand at the DMV for you.
That's right.
And we don't know what they're going to do.
No, that's right. Yeah. we'll call you when your number is right. Yeah, Lulu it says that they can do, I like how it translates, reinforcements for your household.
Yeah.
I think it's like just kind of cleaning. Small craft, taking less than 2 hours, painting, emergency, not just the translation, emergency larger arm.
Okay.
Which means, you know, like somebody to help you move furniture, receive a heavy
muscle. Huh? Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
You need one emergency arm. I would, they can help you out.
You click by number of arms that you need. Yeah.
You know what, Father, though? I could see this being very helpful because sometimes when I'm doing yard work, I just don't have the means to do everything that I need to do. If I could call somebody, just like a neighborhood kid, and be like, hey, can you come help me pull these weeds?
Yeah, and your young daughters are only good enough for dragging one branch at a time.
Exactly.
So you can't press them into
Bless
service
your hearts.
Yet.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, I hate to say you get to pay for friends, but people who can actually do the work with you and they have some motivation to do it.
Right.
I don't know. I don't mind paying somebody to do something that I would ordinarily have to do alone.
No, exactly.
Mm-hmm. They will also manage deliveries arriving at your home. If the neighborhood model is, in fact, what's going on here, I think it's a great idea.
Yeah.
The fact that perhaps I know these people or I'm slightly acquainted with them, watering my plants, feeding my goldfish, who will die anyway. Fait accompli. They will also do, there's some on Lulu that will do courses. So, like, professors will come into your house. Cook food for you. They will bring croissants and home newspapers. I bring your water packs. And I really like this idea. But
I'm liking that.
Yeah. Jeff, would you use a concierge service if it was like your neighborhood?
Probably not. But, I mean, just I have a feeling it's probably not cheap by any means. This is for somebody who can afford it.
It's about €5 for 20 minutes of work. So 20, 40, 60, 80, so 5, 15, 20. So €20, that's what, about $48?
€20, no, it'd probably be about $26.
$26. See, back in the day, I would just double anything.
Yeah, typically, yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, but still, I guess it depends on the work that you need done.
Yeah, true. And really, I'm to that point where I need help, you know, bending over, so... You know, it's like, hey, can you come by and pick up the stuff? You know?
Pick up the screwdriver, please, because I've been trying all afternoon.
Yeah. And it's nice because it's not things that you would have a regular subscription for necessarily. Yeah. You know, if you were in the yard, maybe you don't need help every week doing
right.
it.
Exactly.
But if you're that one weekend that you're pulling weeds, you need someone who's not a young girl. Then I can, you know, I can see that would be something that's useful, you know, for those kind of just... This is the one-time thing. I need, like with moving, that was one of the things that was on there.
Yeah.
I need help moving.
Yeah.
Which it's hard to get people to help you move. So I can definitely see where that would be come in handy.
Yeah.
But then again, you have the issue of strangers touching your stuff and walking away with it.
Oh yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Then they don't get paid.
And then they don't get paid. Yeah.
See, I would pay somebody to bring me croissant and my newspaper. I would.
Oh,
I like that idea. Yeah. Please. €5.
€5. Thank you.
per croissant.
Yeah, exactly. Per croissant. Probably, yeah. But I like the concept, too, that if it is indeed a neighborhood model where you have these kiosks that are in your neighborhood that you can just walk up to, mm-hmm. that there is a community that perhaps begins to be reinitialized. Yeah. And it's not just this cold, pay someone through the internet to do something for me. But that there is maybe perhaps this Benedictine idea of hospitality reemerging, mm-hmm. where people are doing work, but are also getting paid for the work mm-hmm. that they're doing. There's actually, I don't know, it seems to me that that there's a little bit of rerum novarum at work here, possibly, with mm-hmm. some social justice activity, quite possibly. I'll have to ask the ghost of John the 23rd for his... I don't do that because we don't do that. You've read the Old Testament. It's never a good idea.
Yeah,
but I like the idea that there is a social justice aspect to it, that there's somebody in your neighborhood that can help you, and then you can help them as well. So mm-hmm. nice thing.
Yeah, it's a sense of community.
That's right. And I think that one of the things that we're missing in our world is not just the sense of family, but also community, which is that extended family.
Mm-hmm.
And so kudos to Lulu. I hope it works well for them. They actually are looking at expanding those kiosks into all the little major neighborhoods of Paris. So, yeah, it would be strange to see one of those kiosks pop up in the middle of Baton Rouge or of Austin. Although mm-hmm. I could see something like that in Austin.
I could see it in Austin, mm-hmm. especially if they did a kind of a Doctor Who blue.
Oh, yeah. You made a police call box.
Yeah.
Put some Keep Austin Weird stickers on it.
Exactly.
People wouldn't even know that it's not supposed to be there.
They would just sit there. They would queue up.
That's right.
What am I waiting for? I don't know.
Doesn't matter. although I think Jason probably used the service if there were a Doctor Who call box in his neighborhood.
I would. I would. Yeah. All the time.
Because the kiosk is bigger on the inside. Yeah. Oh, well, on that note, if you got the reference, we are. We are the Catholic Underground. You're listening to the Catholic Underground. Dude. Do you know where we got the word dude from?
I do.
You in the back. Yes.
We got it from the term Yankee Doodle.
Yes. That's right. From the song Yankee Doodle. We get the word dude. So dude, one of the most useful words in the English language. Mm-hmm. I am Father Chris Decker, dude at large. Jeff Blackwell, Libby Galino, Jason Elizondo, Ed's in the video cave. Our picks of the week are coming up, but first we wanted to talk a little bit about wearable tech.
Mm.
Now, we have spoken of this earlier on the Catholic Underground, and this was well before the Apple Watch came out. We talked about the Pebble Watch mm-hmm. and those sorts of things.
Yeah.
But more and more, we're seeing that wearable tech is a way in which you will be assimilated. In fact, I could be wrong, but
it's true.
I think we have a partial Borg going on here now.
Yeah.
Yes. What is the device that you've got on your arm, Jason?
I have a Moto 360.
Who makes that?
It's a smartwatch by Motorola. So it's run by Android Wear.
Oh, okay.
So it hooks up to my Android phone. It gives me all my notifications. If I'm using Google Maps, it actually shows me all the directions that I need.
What?
Yeah.
It is. I know, right?
Okay, we like that.
Very nifty.
Yeah.
Huh. So that's your wearable tech, and it talks to your phone. There are all sorts of things that are now able to Borgify you, right?
Yes, mm-hmm. indeed.
So let's see. There's the watch, right, that talks to your phone. But there's even stuff that's working its way into the sports world. And I never thought there was much to this because you see it in the Sky Mall. May it rest in peace. but electrical muscle stimulation, like the clothing that's used by athletes to intensify their workouts while they're working out.
Mm-hmm.
They have these suits that I'm guessing, I haven't read a whole lot on the subject, but they send electrical impulses to their mm-hmm. muscles to help them contract while they're contracting, doing work in a workout. So it's a, kind of an intensification kind of thing. It stimulates different muscles depending on the type and intensity of the exercise. So it's like a smart shirt.
Hmm.
Not to be confused with what they used to have on late night television, where you connect yourself and shock yourself.
And you would just shock yourself.
No, I remember those.
Worst idea.
Father, I have seen those shirts. And actually, those and the ones that monitor as well.
Really?
So I think... Wow. I think
I've seen Under Armour has one.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Under mm-hmm. Armour has one that monitors...
biometrics and whatnot.
Yeah. So, you know, if you're working out, you're on the treadmill, you're, you know, you're lifting weights. It's keeping track of everything that you're doing, and mm-hmm. you know, it's reporting all that information back up to the cloud or to your cell phone, which is scary.
Or your watch,
or which is all scary one way or the other.
That's true. Yeah, Skynet once again, right? So these electrical muscle stimulation or EMS clothes, which I think is an unfortunate acronym because I would need the EMS.
Right.
So the pulses mimic prompts that are given by the brain to flex the muscles. So they're actually intensifying your workout by convincing your body to do more work. I will never wear one of these things.
It would kill me.
What happens if you wear it when you're just sitting on the couch? Does it intensify my workout?
Anytime you see it on the television, right? That's what they're doing, right?
Right.
So you have someone who obviously has spent most of their life at the gym, and they're just sitting there, and they've got the mm-hmm. device on.
I like the way you're thinking there, Olivia.
I don't know if it works that
way. I mean, technically, you're still burning calories when you're sitting on the couch. So if I'm wearing one of these EMS
Not
suits,
if you're eating the whole bag of chips.
No, pass me another biscuit.
Well, no.
Yes, Jeff eats whole biscuits while he's on his couch.
No, he gets them delivered by the Lulu service.
That's right. Exactly.
That's right.
Like fresh croissants so I can watch the morning news.
Where's the cream cheese?
That's another concierge service. Right. Yeah. So, yeah, Olympic athletes use this stuff. And, of course, the monitoring that you were talking about, Jason, that's also there, too. Of course, we know about augmented hearing devices. Mm-hmm. Folks have had hearing aids for quite a while.
What?
except for Jeff. He still uses his ear trumpet.
I'm sorry,
which was
Father.
Very technologically
that
advanced
was not
in its
nice.
Day.
I'm sorry, Father.
That's all right. Fear not. Fear not, Jeff. We'll put one in the budget for.
Bless you.
So, I do miss a good ear trumpet.
I mean, ear trumpets, they're very fashionable in Scandinavia. Right. So the Quiet Pro Plus from a Norwegian company, they're earplugs that cancel out loud or harmful sounds while at the same time amplify human voices or sounds that you wish to be more attuned to. So I could see, Olivia, how something like this might be helpful if you were, I don't know, if you were studying.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you were listening to a lecture. And so to modify your hearing so that you hear the lector's voice,
right.
But you don't hear the stuff going on outside your window or that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Really kind of a fascinating.
Or even I've read about, I forget what they're called, but they're geared for wearing at concerts. Because know how you go to a concert and I remember this one time I went and I felt like my insides were vibrating because they were. And I just remember thinking, this cannot be good for my hearing, but it's so good, you know. But there's this, I'm ashamed that I don't remember what they're called, but that I was reading about something that they're kind of just like regular earbuds, just without the wires, obviously. And you wear them at a concert, and they regulate what you're hearing so that it doesn't damage your hearing, but you can still enjoy the concert. Huh. So something like that I can see being really useful, too.
Yeah, something called the Silent Live or something. Yeah.
Something like that, yeah.
Hmm. Apparently, Samson makes them. Sennheiser makes them.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting. So that way it's augmenting your hearing so that it blocks out all the stuff that would ordinarily destroy your hearing and just gives you enough of the sound. And then, of course, we know that those augmented hearing things are used in the military to increase situational awareness, right? Mm-hmm. I can imagine that would be very helpful. It's funny to think that we're relying so much on technology to do things for our bodies that they wouldn't perhaps ordinarily be able to do on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And are we okay with that?
I think to a point.
Yeah.
I think, you know, What was that movie with Robin Williams where he's the android and they start replacing body parts?
Oh, yes. Yeah. I can't remember the name of that film,
but
which is rare.
There's that some there's a point at which technology is benefits us only so much, and then
right.
it's like now it's just getting creepy.
Then you cross mm-hmm. that threshold,
right, where we rely too much on it, and we're not relying enough on ourselves and on our human bodies, on the things that God has given us.
Right, and I think that's perhaps the bugaboo, if you'll pardon a Louisiana phrase, that's it, right? Is whenever we begin to rely more on the technology than we do on the fact that we are hylomorphic,
mm-hmm.
we are body and soul, and that is the way God intended us to be. Then we start wanting to become the machines, and if I may, isn't that really what the Borg were all about?
Yeah.
I mean, they got to a point where they thought that the only way to become more perfect was to become less human.
Right. Mm-hmm. And the share. And We do it with the technology that we have with sharing information.
Yeah.
So, you know, at what point do we start the hive mind?
Right, exactly. I mean, Google Docs is helpful for us, but I can't imagine it being running in my head for 24 hours a day.
No, stop updating the doc.
That's right. Please stop. It's like whenever you accidentally get into a group text message and you're trying to do something important and it just keeps, I would imagine that going on in your brain. I can't imagine that. No. So yes, there's augmented reality glasses that overlay information in your field of vision, like Jarvis. I have to say that I would like that.
I'll take that.
I would like that, especially if all I have to do is touch the air, and I would probably look like a freakazoid to everybody else. But
then they'd be doing it too. So
yeah. Then they'd be doing
too. Yeah.
If madness is everywhere, then it's normal, right?
That's true. Jeff, would you have a heads up display if it were afforded to you, either by contact or on your glasses?
I don't know that because I thought of Google Glass when you were talking about these type of devices and. I don't know. To me, it's just like it goes against the natural grain. So I don't see that happening anytime soon.
There are some things that are helpful on a different level because there are now wearable drug delivery services. Hmm. I know certainly folks have had the insulin pump for quite a while.
That's true.
They can use that to administer life-saving insulin. But then there, of course, is also an injector kit. So like for chemotherapy or post-chemotherapy injections and things like that, and they're automated and they're monitored. That is I would say that's a very helpful, useful thing. And then, of course, there's also wearable tech that alters one's mood. It's called Think, THYNC. It's a small wearable that changes your mood with electrical impulses applied to your head.
That's crossing.
Yeah, it can be set to calm or energize the wearer. Yeah. It was introduced at CES in 2015, and it's presently on sale. So I really don't feel good about that.
No, that
doesn't make me feel good at all.
I feel like that's highlighting kind of an undercurrent among this all of this wearable technology that you were talking about a minute ago, where. Like, at what point do we stop being responsible for ourselves?
Right.
You know,
right.
If I'm in a bad mood, isn't it up to me to realize I'm in a bad mood and take steps to overcome it or at least not inflict it on other people?
Yeah.
You know, but if I'm relying on technology to regulate my hearing, if I'm not focusing on concentrating myself, then I'm not learning the neurological patterns in order to be able to do it by myself. You know what I mean? I feel like it makes us too dependent in a sense.
Right, I'm just going to push a button, and now I'm happy.
Right,
now
right,
I'm
right.
sad.
Yeah, I mean, how many novels and movies have been written about this very thing, and now here we are at the threshold of it, where we really don't have to use our brains, but we can allow our brains to be used, and that's that is one of the scary things, I think. And so, as Christians, the way that we would look at this is certainly recognizing the utility of some of these things, but while at the same time. Not relying on them as if they are the only utility, right? It's with anything that we're given. Technology, believe it or not, is a gift from God.
Yeah.
Right.
Technology is a gift from God. Pope Paul VI says this over and over and over in Inter Mirifica, that document of the Second Vatican Council, especially communications technology, a gift from God. He has allowed humankind to advance, to acknowledge that there is science to be discovered and uncovered. And yet, we can become a slave to those things as well. And so, I mean, certainly wear the watch, Jason, but what happens whenever that watch becomes all that you look at or all
exactly.
We see that with cell phones now.
Mm. Oh, yeah. All things in moderation, Father.
As St. Benedict would say, which St. Thomas Aquinas would first say, all things in moderation, yeah. So Jeff, is there an element of wearable tech that you would like to see, like maybe something to help you with your daily radio work?
Man, you know, that's one of those things I really haven't thought about, other than, you know, wearable tech like headphones.
Yeah.
I don't know. To me, because a lot of the processes that we do in broadcasting, whether it's radio or TV, you're the same way as an artist, Father.
Yep.
You know, it's all up here. And that's,
it's relying on your mind, and the technology is what allows your mind to to mm-hmm. make the thing work.
Yeah, and especially in our instance, I think the creativity of our mind and our heart, our soul, you know, all combine to do things that you can't program in.
Mm. And I think that perhaps for me would be the linchpin to it all is, yeah. can I become more human mm-hmm. by my use of technology and not less?
Mm. Yes.
Can I become less like a bog and not more?
Man. Yeah,
exactly. Well, we want to know what you think as well. As always, backchat@catholicunderground.com is the way to do that. Or you can go over to facebook.com/catholicunderground and let us know. Tag it episode 290 or something like that. That way we will know that this is what we were talking about so that whenever we come up to the next week's show, we can say, hey, Marissa tagged CU290 and she wants us to know that she actually does already have an implant for radio automation. So that's right behind the ear. That's right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That would be a scary thing indeed. Yeah. Yeah. Well, one of the things that is not scary, though, is us. We are the Catholic Underground. I don't know. We may actually be scary. You're listening to the Catholic Underground. I am Father Chris Decker. Joining us, Jason Elizondo, who is a special guest from the Diocese of Austin. He's a friend of the Catholic Underground. I believe we call him an undergrounder. Hey, Jason.
How you doing, Father?
I am well. Also, we've got Olivia Galino. And over in the cave over there, we've got Jeff Blackwell and Marissa Hornbuckle sitting in. Who's probably, it looks like she's doing important things on the computer. We'll say that she's assisting importantly with Jeff's duties on the satellite there.
Absolutely, of course.
That's right.
Jeff's our one.
That's the story, and we're sticking to it.
Right.
So we've talked about assimilating with technology, and if tech has a way of assimilating us, then prayer and fraternity have the same goal spiritually. We talked about that at the top of the show a little bit with community and kind of weaving our way through technology, talking a little bit about the hive mind. Whenever we get to spirituality with prayer and fraternity, we actually have the ability to assimilate into something that is much bigger than ourselves, that is the mind and heart of God. Mm-hmm. And we know that prayer is the raising of the mind and heart to God. And for a very long time, apostolates and confraternities have been the ways in which we lift our individual prayers collectively together up to the Lord. And so those organizations bring clergy together, they bring the laity together, and they really are opportunities not only of just prayer, but also of true fraternity or sorority.
Mm-hmm.
Outside of the college campus, as it were, you know. And so we thought maybe we'd talk a little bit about what a confraternity is, what is an apostolate, which you hear me speak about quite often, but there are official groups that that come together. So a confraternity is a voluntary association of laypersons created for the purpose of promoting special works of Christian charity or piety, and they are approved by the church. In fact, your parish may have some of these confraternities that are active. Whereas an apostolate is a Christian organization directed towards serving and evangelizing the world. Of course, the operative word there is apostle. Huh? Mm-hmm. The Catholic Underground is an apostolate because we are evangelizing the digital continent. And people like Jason who join us are kind of members within that apostolate because you help out by doing what you do in your daily life as a husband and as a dad.
Right.
While at the same time listening to the Catholic Underground.
Exactly.
And so we join our prayers to yours.
Mm-hmm.
We hopefully evangelize you to some degree and then allow you to be a salt for the earth in your family and in your business.
Exactly.
And well, at the library too.
Oh. And at the bookstore?
At the bookstore, at the supermarket. Any of the things that follow this comma. Now we have, when we talk about confraternities, we're speaking of that association of lay people that come together, like the Knights of Columbus. The Knights of Columbus, of course, are a fraternal benefits organization that help to provide for widows and orphans so that the men and their families can have a suitable burial. But while the Knights of Columbus was founded with that aim, they have become, and they certainly are, an organization that bring men to holiness.
And they are everywhere, Father.
They're everywhere. Mm-hmm. There's a Knights of Columbus Council just about in every town, certainly, mm-hmm. in almost every parish.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. We've got, Austin is a large diocese, and I think every parish, I think, that I've ever been associated with or ever been to has Knights of Columbus there.
Yeah, we don't often hear them called a confraternity, but that's what they are, a confraternity, being brothers with.
Mm-hmm.
And they are officially recognized by the church, so much so that several popes now have called the Knights of Columbus the strong right arm of the church.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, Olivia, I don't know whenever you were in Rome if they were cleaning the outside of St. Peter's.
I don't think there have ever been a couple of
projects where you end up in Rome and there's scaffolding all over St. Peter's. The Knights of Columbus sponsored that. The Knights of Columbus also sponsor the international broadcast for the Christmas and Easter liturgies.
Oh, wow.
The Knights of Columbus partially funded the high-def satellite truck that the Vatican Television Center uses. And so you're seeing not only do you have men who are praying together, men who are seeking holiness together, men who are providing for their wives and children with funeral benefits, but also men who are giving in an apostolate sense to the work of the church. And, of course, another confraternity is the Sarah Club,
mm-hmm.
Praying for vocations.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, St. Vincent de Paul. Jeff, do you know much about the St. Vincent de Paul Society? Because I know, I know that you go to a parish that I think has a very active one.
Yeah.
But...
And I know, through our radio apostolate. Which,
yes.
It's good that you said that, too, because so many people refer to the radio station or the Catholic Underground as a ministry.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But no, to answer your question, I don't know a lot. Mm-hmm. I need to know a lot more. But we have our local...
our St. Vincent de Paul.
St. Vincent, right.
Yeah, we have a diocesan St. Vincent de Paul conference.
Right, right.
And then within each parish can have a confraternity of the Order of St. Vincent de Paul. And so what happens on a diocesan scale for us in the Diocese of Baton Rouge can happen on a parish scale as well. And so you have a group of people that get together as a confraternity, and they pray together, especially for the poor in their parish.
Yes.
And they also have the benefit of taking some of the funds that are perhaps donated to the parish in regular collections or by other means, parishioners giving towards the St. Vincent de Paul conference.
Right, right.
And they discern how best to help the poor in the parish. So they first of all go into the neighborhoods where the poor are. They pray with them in their homes.
Mm.
They assess the situation. What is money needed for? Is money the best thing for you at this point? And then, based upon prayer and discernment, a St. Vincent de Paul conference on a parish level, would discern how best to help with finances that parish. On the diocesan level, the confraternity of St. Vincent de Paul has a soup kitchen. They have homeless shelters. They have a pharmacy,
mm-hmm.
and this is an opportunity again of a confraternity coming together. Also as an apostolate and as an outreach.
Hmm.
And the Second Vatican Council was very clear in its call for more apostolates, more ways in which we are called as Catholics, as Christians, to go out and not just to stay in a building, And so the Acts of the Apostles was very clear that this activity was fruitful in the early church. It wasn't just the apostles doing work. But it was everybody who called themselves a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
They placed their resources at the feet of the apostles. The apostles divvied them out, if you will, each as each needed. And they then went out farther and made disciples. That was the mandate from Jesus to his apostles, and that's a mandate that we share. And it seems to me that that a confraternity is a good way to share that mission and to be enlivened by it.
Well, definitely, Father. I've heard y'all talk about this many times, and I love the idea of a confraternity. I love the idea of groups of ladies getting together, mm-hmm. and praying together. And because as a husband and a father, I'm working all the time,
right?
And I come home and I help my wife, I help Melissa take care of the girls, and then I basically crash.
That's right. And then you go offline.
Exactly. I unplug.
That's right.
But being able to have a group of people that you can get together with,
yep.
on a regular basis and pray for others, and then mm-hmm. do the things that the church is calling us to do is
essential.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing, is oftentimes, first of all, it's worth saying that confraternities even apostolates, you don't hear a lot about it because they somehow disappeared, many of them, after the Second Vatican Council. I have, and I can't blame the council for this. We shouldn't blame the council for it, but rather a misinterpretation thereof, where in my sacristy I have three or four different establishing documents, charters for confraternities in my parish, and I don't know where they are. I mean, I have the document, but I don't see the people you know, meeting the other. And so something happened. But it seems to me that in this world that we live in now, confraternities, apostolates, all the more, Vatican II was prophetic in saying we need more of this, because there is also perhaps a thought that's not quite correct, that unless it's Mass, it doesn't count. Mm-hmm. Unless it's Mass at the parish, I don't need to be at the parish. And one of the things that that I was amazed at in Austin at St. Thomas More, which I believe is a parish that you know something about.
I know about that. That's my home parish.
Exactly. they actually tried to create a place, from what I could see, that is the place that's in between work and home.
Yes. Yes. I mean, because they have a lot of different things that you can do. And I know our good friend, Chris Williston, he takes his kids to the parish all the time for, adoration, and then there's people that work at Mobile Loaves and Fishes, and there's many things that people
can do.
They
have a bookstore.
Exactly.
Yeah. Wow. And a library, a lending library.
It's a whole campus. It's not just, you just don't have the parish.
Right.
You've got Fisher House. You've got all
and
the
And so it's
IPs.
A center of life.
Exactly.
I find. Mm-hmm. And the parish is intended to be a center of life. It's supposed to be a beating heart so that we can become energized to become evangelists. It's not just the priest's job. I spend many a homily talking about that. And the way to do this work is to perhaps get involved in an apostolate or a confraternity so that you can go back to the Mass to be fed and then to go back out. That's what the Acts of the Apostles had in mind. Mm-hmm.
I think you're hitting on something that St. Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians 11, you know, when he talks about how the people in Corinth weren't discerning the body of Christ.
Right.
He wasn't just referring to the fact that they weren't giving enough reverence to the Mass. The examples that he gives are things like neglecting the poor or being overly self-indulgent or starting the Eucharistic feast without the poor being there. Because they were working. So it's little things like that that he's saying, that is not discerning the body of Christ. Hmm. And that's what I think the connection that we're all trying to make here is that living out those apostolates and being available to other people in your community, that's being the body of Christ. That's taking what you do in the Mass and making it
that's right.
applicable.
Exactly. Yeah. So you're taking the mystery that you've celebrated and you are giving flesh to it.
Mm-hmm.
By yourself, with your own body, you are making up. It's interesting because Paul talks about making up what is lacking in the sufferings of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
One of the things that we make up in our bodies once we've received the Eucharist is we make up his hands and his feet. Mm-hmm. And there are those who are suffering in our world that are longing for some form of outreach. And it's not always financial. I think we sometimes forget that it's oftentimes not financial what people need.
Right, right. I mean, sometimes people just need someone to talk to.
Yep.
They need someone to be there for them. And Father, do you think that sometimes people get discouraged by because there's like a ministry, there's not a ministry at their parish that they think that they can get involved in, so they don't actually think about going out into the larger diocese or going out and even getting together with a group of friends and saying, hey, let's do this.
Yeah.
You know, maybe you don't go to my parish and that's fine, but we can still do something. And I think people are like, well.
Right, exactly. Yeah. It's kind of like in high school, right? Whenever you're like, well, I don't know. I'm just going to go home. I don't. I think we can sometimes do that because I have a working theory in the back of my head that many of us never actually graduate high school. We go back into those same sort of psychological mind games, right, that we were supposed to hopefully break out of in high school. But yeah, I think sometimes on a parish level, if there's not something that's already there, we don't attempt to either begin it or to fully discern the body, to fully discern what is needed in our parish as an extension of the body of Christ.
Right.
So yeah, there is some timidity, But again, ask the pastor for guidance, but not governance. You know, speaking as a pastor of two parishes, I want you to start these things. Mm-hmm. I want to see the Knights of Columbus. I want to see the Catholic Daughters. I want St. Vincent de Paul. I want a Holy Name Society. I'm a Knight of the Immaculata. I would love to have a Knight of the Immaculata group meeting. But it's got to be you. And so the pastor is happy to guide it, but he doesn't necessarily have to govern it, right? And they're meant to be lived out in the world and not just the parish.
Right.
You know, that's really the point of it, is that not you're just coming to the parish and saying, okay, this is happening in the bubble of my parish, but it's supposed to spill out into the world. You're supposed to be the salt for the earth, right? Mm-hmm. That's the whole point of a confraternity or an apostolate, to help to be salt for the earth and to help to find more who are seeking that saltiness of life. Yeah. You can also Google apostolates and confraternities, or even arch-confraternities, and certainly you can go into your own parish hall and look at the dusty banners and say, huh, where have those gone? Are they still there? Can I get involved with them? And of course, it's worth mentioning that the Catholic Underground is an apostolate as well. Mm-hmm. And so whenever you watch us, when you listen, you are supporting us as well. First and foremost, please support us by your prayer, because that's why we're still here. Someone was asking, so how long have you guys been around? Since 2006, we've been on podcasting and doing video since 2010. And we are here not because we just like playing with technology, because let me tell you, folks, the technology has not been playing well with us today. But we're here because we want to be part of the body of Christ for you. We want to help you discern how you fit into the body of Christ. And so don't be afraid to reach out to us as well. So we've talked about connecting. We've talked about becoming part of the universal hive mind, if I can say that is being a Christian. But there's also another way in which we can place ourselves in the presence of God, mm-hmm. that is related to the sacraments of the church, but is not specifically a sacrament itself. And of course, we're talking about sacramentals. Sacramentals is one of those words that we don't hear too much anymore, mm-hmm. but sacramentals are still a thing, Olivia.
It is, and it sounds like sacraments, so right. Maybe it's just a different way of saying, no, it's not. Mm. things that sacramentals are not. They're not magic. They're nope. not means of superstition, and they're not sacraments. But things like, and they're really common, things like rosaries, holy water, holy yep. salts.
Things that we as Catholics use very often, mm-hmm. and don't think about.
Exactly. Blessings are sacramentals, and how often do you ask a priest for a blessing over your other sacramentals? So
that's
it's
right.
just
that's right.
an inception exactly. of sacramentals.
Statues in your church, mm-hmm. or statues in your car, or statues in your studio, or in your home.
Mm-hmm.
Also sacramentals.
Yeah.
So what makes them sacramental?
Well, we can turn to the catechism for some guidance here. Sacramentals are sacred signs which signify effects, particularly of a spiritual nature, which are obtained through the intercession of the church. By them, men are disposed to receive the chief effect of the sacraments, and various occasions in life are rendered holy. So basically, sacramentals, they aren't sacraments, because sacraments means that they're efficacious in grace. They give you grace.
That's right. They are the outward signs instituted mm-hmm. by Christ primarily to give grace to you. The sacrament itself dispenses grace.
Exactly.
When I receive the Eucharist is the vehicle of grace to make me holy.
Right. And so the sacramentals come in. They're kind of a helper, because they help dispose you to the grace.
It's the adjective of the Catholic world.
There you go.
Yeah.
Everything comes back to grammar.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I think about sacramentals. They're things that help you in order to fully be in that grace and participate in that divine life that the grace gives you.
So if you think about it, like a crucifix, right? Mm-hmm. If I wear a crucifix, or if I have one on the wall and I like to pray with it, or maybe, you know, if it's around my neck, it's something that I can take it and look at from time to time. Mm-hmm. That crucifix is supposed to transport me to the nearest sacrament, if you will, right?
Mm-hmm.
The crucifix might remind me of my own sinfulness, mm-hmm. And it was me that put the Lord on the cross, and so it might be that sacramental that drives me to the sacrament of reconciliation, right?
Right. Yeah, and that's the whole point, is that they're outward signs of an inward reality. Mm-hmm. And we were talking about symbols last week and how important yep. they are. You know, if you look at the crucifix and you just stay with the crucifix, you know, it's a corpus on a cross, then you're not really entering into it. But if you do like Father Chris says, and it leads you to the sacrament of reconciliation or the Eucharist or adoration even, which is not in itself a sacrament, but it's the adoration of one, mm-hmm. Then that's really entering into, and that's how the sacramental of the crucifix has helped you enter into a deeper reality. So it's kind of a gateway for you, the good kind of gateway.
Yeah, I have actually have a crucifix on my desk at work.
Oh.
So I use it. I center. It helps me. I can look at it. I look at it sometimes, especially when things are really bad.
Mm-hmm. Maybe the spice is not being mined as quickly as it should be, and you have to kind of refocus.
But it brings you back to the grace, like you said, of the Eucharist.
Yeah.
That if you're lucky enough to be able to go to daily mass,
yeah,
it can help you say, hey, you know what? Maybe I need to go to daily mass today or tomorrow,
mm-hmm.
and or maybe I need to go to reconciliation this weekend. Maybe I was a little bit. Not nice to one of my employees.
Yeah.
So it brings you exactly to what you said, Father. It brings you back to the sacrament.
And like you were saying, to piggyback on the next citation from the Catechism, it says, sacramentals do not confer the grace of the Holy Spirit in the way that the sacraments do, but by the church's prayer, they prepare one to receive grace, and they dispose a person to cooperate with it. So whenever we say that sacramentals, like a religious medal, is not a talisman that has this magic power in and of itself, but it disposes me to receive grace.
Mm-hmm.
And so in a sense, it does have a spiritual authority in the sense that it is pointing me towards an encounter with the Lord, towards an encounter with the sacraments.
Mm-hmm.
It's supposed to vivify me in a way where I want to go and receive some font of grace, which of course we know the Eucharist is the source and summit of those graces as well.
Mm-hmm.
But I suppose it's even worth saying, Jeff, that a well-used sacramental can also help me discern my vocation in life too.
Wow.
Yeah.
I love that.
In fact, I will tell you that,
profound.
That
I love it.
I had really no devotion to speak up to the Holy Rosary until about a month or two before I entered the seminary.
Hmm.
And, I mean, I had my first communion rosary. It was, you know, sitting there at the head of my bed. And all of a sudden, right after I'd finished signing my paperwork to go to the seminary, I began to feel very kind of depressed, alone, isolated. And I didn't know where this was coming from. And so one night, as I was feeling kind of this bereft, like, I just signed up, Lord. What do you? I don't understand what's going on. I grabbed the rosary. I had the little pamphlet of how to pray it. And I started praying the rosary. And I realize now, you know, 9 years a priest almost, I realize that was spiritual warfare.
Mm. Mm.
And the Lord was even using this experience of temptation, this experience of despair, to drive me towards an experience of grace. And he used the sacramental through his Blessed Mother's Rosary to do that.
Oh, that's beautiful.
That is what the sacramentals are about. That's why they're there. It's not just to hang around your rearview mirror.
Right.
You know?
Right.
It's like I tell my parishioners all the time, please don't put the rosary around your neck unless you know how to pray it. And then if you are praying it, you're not going to wear it around your neck
because
you know why it's there. You know?
That's right.
So yeah, they help us to experience a deeper sense of longing.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It sounds to me.
And I think that's why it's important that they're bodily things. You know,
the
rosary
they
is something
are.
That you do with your hands. Holy water is something that causes you to make a gesture. Mm-hmm. You put it on yourself. It's a reminder of your baptism. A lot of these sacramentals are bodily.
Interactive.
Yeah, and that's so important, and I think it's so beautiful because it tells us something about who we are. We are bodily.
Yeah.
You know, I am my body. And it reminds us when we're praying with the rosary or looking at a crucifix, we're engaging our body in order to reverence some aspect of our faith, to reverence the Lord most of all. And it's important because we have to, it fights against a kind of dualistic sense of the person, you know,
yeah.
I'm not only spiritual, I am bodily. And it's something that I love because we get from the Jews, you know, the Jews pray with the phylacteries and the tefillin and,
yeah.
And they move a lot when they pray, and it's to remind them that they are the whole person. And it causes you to bring your whole self into your prayer. And so if you're bringing your whole self into your prayer, then you're bringing your whole self into the Eucharist. You're bringing your whole self, you're throwing yourself at the altar saying, like, I'm yours. And you can't get more devoted than that, you know?
I wonder if we could say, this is Father Chris Decker, Speculative Theology 101, could we say that the Mass is a sacramental for the sacrament of the Eucharist?
We could.
Mm-hmm.
I think we could.
I think you could.
Because this is something we're doing with our voice, with our body, which is why you should sing, which is why you should respond. which is why the Second Vatican Council talks about these sorts of things. And actually, this is why the Mass of the Ages in the Extraordinary Form also involves a kind of active participation that's completely different, where we are entering fully into a mystery that is preparing us to receive the ultimate mystery, mm-hmm. which is the Eucharist. So yeah, other instances of sacramentals, the liturgical year, mm-hmm. the hours of the liturgy, liturgy of the hours, genuflection, bowing the head, prostrating ourselves, folding of our hands, the blessing of people, exorcism, blessed salt, ashes, oil, water, fire, candles, rosary, scapulars, blessed medals, the Agnus Dei, crucifixes, icons, statues, altars, washing of feet, church buildings, vestments, wedding rings, religious habits, my cassock, mm-hmm. liturgical vessels, bells, incense, and blessed palms. These are all sacramentals that point to the deeper reality of the sacraments.
Mm-hmm. That's a whole lot of sacraments.
And those are only some of them. That's just some of them.
So, Father, what would you say is a good way? Because I know some people have that thought in their mind that sacramentals are, like you talked about earlier, kind of a talisman.
Yeah.
You know, I do this thing, I say this prayer because it's going to get me what I'm asking for if I only unleash the power of the sacramental. So how do we avoid that kind of superstitious mentality?
The person that uses the sacramental properly doesn't have this kind of cause and effect. If I say this prayer, then this will happen. Mm-hmm. That's what people on daytime TV talk about. but the Christian who uses the sacramental properly says, I wish to experience the risen Lord. I wish for a deeper, deeper relationship with God. That is my primary desire as a human being longing for God. And so I am reminded by the use of this object of how deep that desire is. This object reminds me to seek mercy, to seek forgiveness for my sins, and to seek to enter more deeply into the church. Mm-hmm. And so in that way, the sacramentals do have a protective power over me because they're reminding me to move into the right disposition. Huh? It always brings us to do that. We would be remiss if we didn't move along a little bit here and go to that part of the show that we like to call
the CU Pick of the Week.
Alrighty, for our first CU Pick of the Week, do you have one, Jason? I didn't ask you before the show, but do you?
I actually do have one, Father.
Lovely.
We are on a road trip, as the people may or may not know. Mm. They probably don't because we didn't talk about it.
We didn't.
No, but
he's road tripping, by the way.
I'm road tripping. So my best friend on a road trip has been the app called Waze.
Oh, Waze.
Yeah, it's a crowdsourcing traffic app.
Oh yeah.
So
I like Waze a lot.
It lets you know whether or not you know the best way to go, the fastest way, and whether or not there's something that mm-hmm. might be in your path that mm-hmm. might slow you down.
And one of the cool things about Waze too is if you have a passenger like your wife there mm-hmm. in the car, there's a chat option so you can actually figure out why the traffic is not moving.
Exactly. Oh, yeah. Wow. It's nice. It's a wonderful app, and actually they were bought by Google not too long ago.
They were. And so Google Maps actually
incorporate.
Yeah, they scrabble that data and put that on Google Maps mm-hmm. as well.
Exactly. So that is my pick of the week. It is a wonderful app.
That's a great pick of the week, my friend.
It's a good one.
Olivia, what is your pick of the week?
Olivia? Is that my name now? Well, I was inspired by our conversation on wearable technology.
Oh.
And it reminded me of this article I read about stretchable nanowire mesh that you can wear. It looks kind of like chainmail, but you know, the modern version of chainmail.
And who doesn't like modern chainmail?
Who doesn't love some good chainmail? But it's the heating pad, kind of. It's an update on a heating pad idea. And it's completely flexible. It's thin, so you can wear it under your clothes, and it conforms to your body. So I like that because it's something, you know, if you want to extend it into the sports arena mm-hmm. or even just for ordinary people who I can't wear a heating pad every day if I have back pain, but I could wear something like this and it wouldn't impede my function or it wouldn't look weird under my clothes. So I just think it's really cool what people are doing with that kind of stuff.
Yeah. The notion that we can have something that's a fiber thin
mm-hmm.
that is still giving us the benefit. That's really kind of cool.
And it protects you from a broadsword to the side.
And it does protect you from a broadsword to the side, which, as we all know,
dual purpose.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, like, but will Waze tell you what a popo is?
They do, actually. That is correct, yes.
I was just wondering.
In fact, so well does that work that there are several states and state police organizations that are trying to outlaw it.
Oh.
Yeah, because it messes up the speed trap situation.
Oh, okay, yeah. All right.
Yeah, yeah. You might need to wear your chain mail. Jeff Blackwell, your pick of the week.
Well, Father, speaking of wearable technology, my pick of the week this week is something I've been looking at because when it comes to technology and sound, PA systems and what have you, church sound, and you know, as far as youth
all
groups
stuff
go,
that you're involved in.
Yeah. One of the things that Shure has come out with, Sennheiser was kind of the leader in this for years, but personal monitor systems, you know, the in-ear monitors that a lot of bands are using now. And the reason they do that is for, you know, because when some guys get crank and they really like have to have the monitors, the floor monitors turned up more and more and more and more.
And you can always tell when they really get into the music because they rip the monitor out of their ear and they just get after it. Yeah.
But Shure's come out with a pretty, I think, nicely priced one for about $700. It comes with earbuds. It's the wearable receiver and then the rack mount transmitter.
And that's the whole thing.
Yeah. It's sort of an all-in-one package, and then you can add additional, if you needed to, receivers as you go along. But you can. It gives you the option of doing like a personal monitor mix if you'd like. You can set that up with your sound guy. But the thing that I really like about this, first of all, it's got a long distance wireless coverage of about 300 feet, or how would you say 90 meters?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. In your neck of the woods, but it runs on a couple of AA batteries, and man, you can just go out in the crowd and just still hear yourself. Runs on AA batteries. It's cool. It's really got some great features. The thing that I like is if you have active monitors, speakers that are powered, you can just strap one of these receivers on the back of your speaker. You don't have to run cables to them. So,
that's very
it's kind of cool. So, anyway, it's the
it's a pricey pick of the week. But if you're an audiophile like Jeff is, and you actually work in the industry, as some of you do, that's definitely a good thing to have. Yeah. My pick of the week, actually, this is my my 11th inning stretch here. This book is called Freedom Under God by Fulton J. Sheen. With everything that's been going on in our country, I've had this book for a while and have only recently just I saw it and I was like, maybe I should pick it up and read it. Mm. This is an important touchstone to understanding a lot of the philosophy and the issues going on in our society. Fulton Sheen, above many things, was a great philosopher. He could put rational thoughts together and then imbue them with a theology that that is on top of the philosophical undergirding. It's actually quite readable. Fulton Sheen, the good archbishop there, has a venerable wit because he is venerable. So so if you like a little dry humor, there's that too. That's my pick of the week, Freedom Under God by Fulton J. Sheen. This week, Catholic Underground is possible because of people like you. Join the growing number of undergrounders at catholicunderground.com/donate. And Jeff, we thank those who support us, don't we?
Absolutely. Portions of the Catholic Underground are brought to you by audibletrial.com/catholicunderground. That's audibletrial.com/catholicunderground. And also by Mystic Monk Coffee. More information at catholicunderground.tv.
That's right. We are on Facebook at catholicunderground.com/Facebook, or the other way around. Strike that, reverse it. We're on Twitter at Digital Catholic. Our panelists have been Olivia Galino. Thank you, Olivia.
Thank you all.
Also, Jason Elizondo.
It has been a pleasure.
Our technical director is Jeff Blackwell. Thank you, Jeff.
A privilege, Father.
Our research assistant and the leader of the boys in the lab is Jim Hayes. Our video director is Ed Ball. And you know me, I am Father Chris Decker. You can follow me on Twitter at Digital Catholic. We hope we've helped you cut through the noise here for Catholic Underground. We'll see you next time.
From the Catholic.